So far, we have learned throughout this series of sessions that what is business analysis, what are the typical phases in business analysis, how the business analyst interface with various stakeholders in a given project. We have also learned some of the techniques which are widely used in business analysis. We have seen what are the tasks that we need to perform as a business analyst for a given project. Also, we have had hands-on on some crucial requirement designing techniques like wireframes, process modeling, UML use cases. We have also written some user stories. Now, this is the final topic in our session, that is BA role in quality assurance. So, this is where your business analysis role gets ended in a typical given project lifecycle. Now, here in today's session, we are going to understand the business analyst and quality assurance hierarchy. We would also understand some of the important milestones for business analyst and quality analyst. We would also see a career role comparison for business analyst and quality analyst. After that, we would learn what is business analyst role in testing, and we would see some of the career risk for business analyst and quality analyst. Now, if you are working as a quality analyst in a given particular project, maybe it could be any nature of project, whether it's end-to-end product development, or it's a maintenance support project, or it's a what I would say new development project. Quality analyst has an important role to play. Why his role is important? Because he is the person who would essentially certify the product. Certify the product as in whatever functionality you have written from a business analysis standpoint, or whatever functionality the development team has coded so far. The quality analyst is a person who would validate that particular functionality and essentially give his or her sign off. So quality analyst has a very important role to play when it comes about certification of a particular feature in a particular project. So if anything happens, the quality analyst would be the first person who would be held responsible for not certifying the product properly or not validating the functionality properly. So that's the reason why quality analyst has a very important role to play in today's project. Now, you might have heard that day by day, the quality analyst role are getting, what I would say, are on the verge of extinct. So, this is not true completely. Yes, there are a lot of automations going on from a quality standpoint. There are many things which are being automated these days. So, automation is replacing the quality analyst role, but not in every case. So if you consider a banking domain project, whatever midstream system or whatever backend system, those are the system that could be easily automated, but you cannot automate the front-end system completely, because if you go on automating it, it would require a hell lot of time. The reason being, there is a manual quality assurance expected out there, and in order to perform the manual quality assurance, you need to have a very strong domain knowledge. Because if you go on automating a particular process, there are n number of scenarios that would come up when you are manually testing a particular feature or scenario within a particular domain. Domain can be insurance, finance, or banking, or healthcare, anything. But if you are automating a particular product, you would automate only the process which are repetitive in nature. Repetitive as in they are bound to happen, or in other words, I could say the common processes are the processes which are eligible to be automated very frequently. But what about the other out of box features which requires a manual validation or verification? For that reason, quality assurance is still a booming industry in today's landscape as well. So manual testing is more when you are वेरीफाइंग और वैलिडेटिंग अ प्रोडक्ट फ्रॉम अ सिनेरियो पर्सपेक्टिव और फ्रॉम अ डोमेन पर्सपेक्टिव, एंड ऑटोमेशन और ऑटोमेटेड टेस्टिंग इज मोर फ्रॉम अ स्टैंड पॉइंट वेर इन यू आर ऑटोमेटिंग द रेपिटेटिव प्रोसेस इन नेचर, द प्रोसेस विच आर मोर फ्रीक्वेंटली हैपनिंग इन अ पर्टिकुलर सिस्टम. Now, what are these processes which are more frequently happening in a particular system, like taking a backup every day, executing a batch process, or for that matter, entering some information from one system to other system? So these are some of the processes which are eligible candidate for automation. Now let us understand the BA and QA hierarchy in a particular project. Now what's the difference between quality and quality assurance? Can anyone tell me what could be the difference between quality and quality assurance? What do you understand by the term quality?
It can be a characteristic of a particular product, like a software can be robust.
Okay, let me give you an object and you tell me what could be a quality for that particular object. Let's say we have purchased a particular ebook from a particular website like Amazon. And the ebook is about how to start your career as a business analyst. So, as a quality analyst person, how would you define that it meets the highest quality standard? The book name is How to Start Your Career as a Business Analyst. How would you measure that the quality of the book is meeting the highest level of standards?
By reading it thoroughly.
Okay, you read it thoroughly and you understood that okay, this quality meets my criteria. But what about the other? Let's say you are writing a review for that particular book in Amazon that this book is very nice. So there has to be certain measurable characteristics. Characteristics is fine, but it has to be measurable. Measurable as in what are the content in the book? Whether the book meets the market standard or not, if you are saying, the author is saying how to start your career as a business analyst. So it is very important that what is the profile of the author, whether he has prior experience in quality assurance or not, that is the second measurable characteristic. Third measurable characteristics could be depending on the content of the book, whether the information which are given in that book, whether it is meeting the current market scenario or not, because that book may be written 2 to 3 years ago, but is it still eligible to be considered for reading, or is it worth reading? Because you have to do some research in and around it, whether whatever is mentioned in that particular book, is it meeting the current industry trends or not. These are some of the measurable characteristics depending on which you would measure the quality of that product. Similarly, if you consider a particular cell phone, if you consider a particular laptop, you would be measuring its quality by depending on the measurable characteristics. If you consider the quality of a particular laptop, you would see whether the genuine copy of Windows is available or not. If it is available, which is the version of it? What is the configuration of the RAM? What is the configuration of the hard disk? Whether it's a HDD or it's a SSD laptop? What is the boot uptime of that particular laptop, or whether that laptop has all the necessary ports which would be in use in your day-to-day life, like it is having one USB port or two USB port. This way you would measure the quality of that particular product. So similarly, in our project context as well, we would be measuring the quality of the feature or the quality of a functionality by deciding some of the test cases. Now, this test cases can be positive test cases, this test cases can be negative test cases. So, basis on the accumulation of the result, we would assure or we would certify that this particular functionality is working 100% as it is described in the requirement. If there is any issues, then you would raise a defect or bug in that particular system. Now, can anyone tell me what's the difference between a defect and a bug? So, we see two kinds of items in a particular project. One kind of item is bug and one kind of item is defect. Are they two different thing or same thing? If it is same thing, then it's fine. If it is different thing, how they are different? I mean, how they are different?
Bug is kind of a fault in the development, and the defect we can say it's a fault of the requirement.
Yes, absolutely. So, for example, if I am writing a piece of requirement and there is something that has been missed by the developer in terms of implementing that requirement, then that missing component would be considered as defect. Now, let's say all of a sudden you are getting an error page. Error page as in you are navigating through a series of page and all of a sudden a page break happened, because of which you cannot move ahead to that particular system. In that case, that particular issue would be called as bug. So, bug is something, if happened in a particular system, you cannot proceed further. It would be as a roadblock to you. But defect is something you can proceed further with the system, but that particular component is missing from your actual requirement specification. So, whenever a quality assurance inspects your particular functionality or a system, he essentially raises these two kind of issues, either it is bug or defect. Now, what kind of testing generates what kind of issues? So, whenever you are testing from a functional standpoint, functional testing, the outcome would be defect. But when you are doing a system testing, the outcome would be bug essentially. So, it depends on the nature of testing that the quality assurances, quality analyst is performing. Now, in similar nature, can anyone tell me at least one particular characteristic which is common for both quality analyst and business analyst? Anything that comes into your mind, which would be common for both quality analyst and business analyst?
Communication skills.
Soft skills apart. Soft skills would be common for everyone. Don't you think functional knowledge and domain knowledge has to be of same level for both quality analyst and business analyst? Both should understand the system or the functionalities from a domain perspective equally. Because if he do not know how the business works, how he would give a assurance, how he would certify a particular product. So functional knowledge is something that has to be common for both your quality analyst and business analyst. That's the reason why we have a particular designation these days emerging called as BAQA. BAQA means business analyst in quality assurance. So this is a specialized designation wherein the business analysts do the quality assurance work. So this is very booming these days. Now we have already seen the organization of the industry or the project in our earlier sessions. We'll just revisit it. How the project roles are mapped. So here we have a project manager, we have a business analyst, and we have a quality analyst. So during inception and planning phase, your project manager would be heavily involved. During your requirement elicitation, requirement gathering, requirement design, your business analyst would be involved heavily. During development, your project manager would be involved in that particular project. Then during quality assurance, your quality assurance team would do the necessary testing. And finally, in the UAT and delivery, your business analyst would be involved. And in addition to that, throughout these phases, planning, tracking, and monitoring is the accountability of your project manager. So in a given project, if we consider the management landscape, the project manager, the business analyst, and the quality analyst, we see their role mapping to these phases. So BA is essentially responsible for four phases: requirement elicitation, requirements gathering, requirements design, and UAT and delivery. QA is responsible for only one phase, that is quality analyst. Whereas the project manager is primarily responsible for tracking all these phases. But if a management role is considered, then in inception and planning, he has a high influence, followed by your development team, because he has to track the development work on a daily basis, track and monitor. If there are any issues, then he could communicate to the business stakeholder. If there are any requirement gap, he would communicate to the business analyst, and so on. Now let us understand some of the important milestones for BA and QA. So these are something which are common to both business analyst and quality assurance, like domain specialization, whether it's banking domain, insurance domain, retail domain, healthcare domain, or telecom domain. Domain specialization is a must for both BA and QA role. So let's say you are working on a particular project, whether it's insurance domain or banking domain. So these domain itself has a series of certifications to be completed. So they have various level of certification that needs to be completed. So this certification are something which are exclusive to domain itself. They are no way related to your methodology like agile, waterfall, and so on, or no way related to business analysis like your various business analysis certification you have. They are exclusive to your particular domain. For example, if I had to show you the certification for insurance domain, so there is a website called as The Institute. So this particular website has, or I would say this is the Bible of all the insurance professionals who are working in insurance domain. So they have their own set of certification. So if you see, these are the certification path which you could pursue as a business analyst working in an insurance domain. Now this certification has no inclination towards your methodology like agile, waterfall, scrum, XYZ, or towards the approach like your business analysis, quality assurance. So you have to have this domain specialization, and it is applicable for both the BA role and the QA role. Similarly, if you consider the hierarchy in particular domain, so now like we have hierarchy in project management, like we have hierarchy or the phases in business analysis, like we have requirements the pre-study phase followed by the discovery phase, then requirement analysis, requirement gathering, requirement elicitation, requirement designing, and so on. Domain also has some hierarchy or some phases. Let us consider an example of personal banking domain. Banking domain. In banking domain, we have personal banking, we have digital banking, we have retail banking, we have investment banking. Within investment banking, we have asset management, we have wealth management, we have capital markets, we have compliance and risk, we have fraud management. So this way, domain also has certain hierarchy basis on which projects are executed. So tomorrow, let's say you are appearing for a interview wherein they are asking for a business analyst in investment banking. So you are supposed to know these hierarchy within investment banking, like what is asset management, wealth management, capital markets, compliance and risk, fraud management. And each of these would be having their own set of activities, processes, and functions to follow. So this way, depending on the nature of the project, you are supposed to have both, this is applicable for both business analyst and quality assurance people, you are supposed to have that much level of in-depth knowledge in that particular subject matter. So that's the reason why we have subject matter expert in place. So subject matter expert is a designation which is given to a particular person only when he has diverse portfolio experience in that particular domain. For example, if he has working in banking domain since last 15 to 20 years, So the subject matter expert is supposed to know all of the functions within the banking domain, which includes everything. So it's not like that anyone can become a subject matter expert. No, he has to, what I would say, abide to a certain set of parameters basis on which that designation is given to them. And in a particular company, the subject matter expert would be very minimal in nature. So they would be maybe a handful of 20 to 25 people, not more than that. But those 20 to 25 people are the people who have the highest level of knowledge in that particular domain, whether it's banking, insurance, or any XYZ domain. Then a characteristics which is common for a particular BA and QA is the business process proficiency. Now, what is business process proficiency? We have already covered business process modeling. So every industry has a set of processes to follow. For example, if we consider the mobile banking or the banking infrastructure, so in that, mobile, online mobile and tablet banking is a business process. Mobile check deposit is a business process. Text alert and e-statements is a business process. Online bill pay and virtual card payment support is a business process. Similarly, this all are the processes within your digital banking process. Okay, so earlier we saw a digital banking. So within digital banking, these are a set of processes. And within investment banking, these are the hierarchy. So remember, there's a difference between hierarchy and processes. So this is hierarchy. So each of these hierarchy, asset management, wealth management, capital market, would be having a certain set of business processes. Similarly, your digital banking is having these many business processes under them. So first come your domain, then comes the hierarchy, and then comes the business processes within those particular domain. So this is how your domain is organized. And a BA and QA is supposed to know equally about the domain aspect in a particular project, without which their role is of no use in the industry. Like I said, both BA and QA are eligible to become a subject matter expert. Now, any reason why QA is also a eligible candidate for subject matter expert? Because BA is supposed to know the requirements functionally and he is supposed to mentor the entire team, then why QA can also become a subject matter expert? Any idea?
Because he also have the wide range of
yes,
domain knowledge.
Absolutely. And he is the person who has actually navigated through the system. Navigated through the system means he has the actual hands-on on the system, like what flow starts from which screen, which flow ends at which screen, what are the intermediate steps. So he has more hands-on knowledge compared to a business analyst. Business analyst is someone who has written the requirement, who has taken approval from the team, and he has forwarded that particular requirement. And some minimal testing he does in the UAT phase. But quality assurance people are the people who firstly know the product in and out, and secondly have the similar or same level of knowledge as a business analyst. So both QA and BA are eligible to become as a subject matter expert. Now, the other characteristics which are common to both for BA and QA is the documentation proficiency. Now, if you see the business analyst documentation, we have the high level documentation like a BRD. We have a low level documentation like a functional spec. And then we have other artifacts like business case, UML, wireframes, data modeling, business cases, process modeling, test-driven development artifacts, and so on. So similarly, if you are intending to have a common characteristics which are common to both BA and QA, so these are also a common characteristics which the both BA and QA refers in a particular project. So if a QA is supposed to validate a particular functionality, so he has to refer these artifacts. So you could say it in that context, although the QA, the quality analyst, do not create this document, but he has the knowledge about what and how the documents are organized what section signifies what. So that is also an important aspect when it comes to categorizing commonalities between the level of knowledge of both QA and B. So he has the similar set of knowledge in terms of documentation like the B, because they are referring those documents. Now, if you compare the skills proficiency, again, the skills are also same, soft skills for both BA and QA, like active listening and negotiation, conflict management and decision making, problem solving and strategic thinking, presentation, public speaking, and team building. So, these set of skill sets are common to both BA and QA. Now, we have seen which are the roles which are common to both BA and QA. Now, we will see a comparison between the role of BA and QA. So, if you consider where BA and QA roles differ, the accountability. So, business analyst is accountable for writing the requirements irrespective of whatever phases he is creating those particular requirements. All the requirements are accountability of a business analyst. But a quality assurance person's accountability is to manage the test plan, test strategy, and test cases. Now, when it comes to planning and management, BA essentially manages the analysis phase, whereas the QA manages the quality assurance or testing phase. When it comes to scope of work, BA is accountable, or his scope of work is just to write the requirement, whereas the quality assurance person's scope of work is to certify the end functionality, which has to be delivered to the end customer. When it comes to delivery, the BA is supposed to deliver or do some UAT testing as and when required, whereas quality assurance deliverable are to just finalize and certify the functionality during the quality assurance phase, not beyond it. After quality assurance phase, whatever issues come, that is something that has to be handled by a business analyst during the delivery or UI. So this is how, basis on the parameters, both BA and QA roles differ. Like where BA and QA roles are common, so BA and QA roles are common in requirement analysis because they are referring to the artifacts which are already created by a business analyst. They do the analysis. So initial level of analysis is something the business analyst could do. The next level of analysis is something the quality assurance would do, when they would be referring to the business analyst documentation. They would create their test plan, test strategy, and test cases accordingly based on the outcome of their analysis result. Then comes your requirement understanding. Both BA and QA have to have a same level of requirement understanding, because if they do not understand the requirement, they cannot perform further testing. So again, here the BA and QA would have a similar understanding to happen. Then comes your requirement traceability. So which requirement is linked to what other requirement? That is also something which is common for both BA and QA, because basis on that, they would link their test cases, test plan, and test strategy to the requirement. And then requirements delivery, that is when the quality assurance would certify the product or the feature, and the business analyst would perform the UAT and hand over the final product to the customer. So these are some parameters wherein the BA and QA roles are common. Now let us understand what is business analyst role in testing. Now if you see a project life cycle, we would first examine what is the role of a QA, quality assurance person, in project life cycle. So this is your project life cycle: requirements, design, build and test, that is development, implement, wherein you do all the testing, and transition, final delivery. So what essentially a QA does in project life cycle? During requirement, he analyzes the requirements for testability purpose, whether whatever requirements are being gathered are they testable or not. During design phase, what they do, they plan the test cases to ensure the quality of the product. For example, if you have written the data dictionary, so they would be writing the test cases in and around that particular data dictionary. During the build and test phase, they observe, ensure what is built and solves the problem. They conduct testing and they ensure customer satisfaction. During your development and testing phase, they ensure whatever the product end product is being developed, they meets the customer satisfaction or not, which is also a role for business analyst. Then during the implementation phase, or the what I would say the core testing phase, they do ensure users and stakeholders are ready to receive the product or not. This is essentially they certify the particular product. It is 100% meeting the requirement guidelines. They do alpha testing or beta testing as per their requirement, and during the transition phase, they observe the product in business environment and they make sure the problem is solved, and if there are any issues, they would log it as a bug or defect. This is a quality assurance role in a project lifecycle. Now, what does a software tester do and how he interfaces with different stakeholders? So software tester essentially interfaces with business analysts, developers, project manager, any other stakeholder, some user communities and some sponsors. So if you consider the interfacing part of a software developer and a business analyst, they interface with them to acquire requirements and change requests. What are the requirements and what are the change requests? So for that reason, they go for the search of business analyst. When it comes to development team, they understand or create the user acceptance test cases, which are created by your developers, or the unit test cases, how they have created or validated the functionality. For that matter, they go to the development team and they also communicate bugs and resolves issue with the development team. So that is the reason why they interface with the development. If you consider how a tester interfaces with a project manager, they do send them the test matrix and root cause analysis of the bugs. If there is a bug, what is the root cause of that particular bug? For that reason, they interface with the project manager. For the user communities, they interface for the alpha and beta testing. Now, can anyone tell me what it could be, the user community? Who are these people? Okay. Do anyone remember that if you are using an Android smartphone, the current version that is available in Android smartphone is Android O, and the version is available to some selective user, the upcoming version Android P, for their verification and testing purpose. So those selective users are who? To whom Android P is available as a test? Before their official launch, those are nothing but the user community. Okay, so user communities are the people who are actual end user to whom the initial release of the software is given before their commercial launch. For in our example, in the Android P release, the version is not yet commercially available, but still it is available to selective users on a trial basis. So what they are essentially doing, they are essentially doing a alpha or beta testing, or rather beta testing. Now, end users are not essentially testing the product. They are using the product, but whatever bug or issues are arising out of that product, they are directly coming to the software tester. Through software tester, they go to the development team. They don't have to log an issue like in Jira, you are logging a defect or bug. They would be using the system like they are using any other system. But if, for instance, a particular application launch crashes, so there is an option that send report. So whenever you send a report, it essentially comes to the software tester who validates it and then goes to the development team. So when it comes to user communities, it's a massive group of people who are essentially testing your product prior to their commercial release or commercial launch. Then the software tester interfaces with other stakeholders for user acceptance test and clarify and approve the software. Now, who are those other stakeholders? They are the representative of the business or the sponsors. And similarly, to sponsor, they would communicate the this much percent of the software is complete, or this many feature of the particular software is complete. So software tester, to summarize, acts like a security gate to ensure quality software that meets business expectation. So end goal for both BA and QA is essentially same. They have to meet the business expectation. Now, if you consider various types of testing, so these are the types of testing they perform: acceptance, black box, compatibility, conformance, functional, integration, load, performance, regression, smoke, stress, system, unit, and white box testing. So unit testing is something more the developer team does. Now, the stress testing, load testing, performance testing are something that are automated in a given project. So your tools like Selenium or any XYZ tool, they are capable of doing these testing. They cannot be done manually. Same goes for integration as well. They cannot be done manually. Now, these are some of the software testing tools. If you are doing a functional automation, then these are the set of tools. If you are doing a load testing, then these are set of tools. If you are using a test management tool, then these are set of tools which you could use. Now, there is an important thing called as verification and validation. Now, verification in quality control is like whether the business specification is meeting the requirement document, meeting the feature that has been coded in the by the development team. For example, you are having a specification, it could be any requirement specification. You have to verify essentially whether the requirement documentation is meeting the objective of what has been coded in the system or not. That is your verification. And validation is something wherein you validate the other scenarios in and around that particular system. So if you have to summarize it in a similar statement, validation is something, are you building the right thing? And verification is something, are you building it right? So are you building it right would obviously come from the requirement specification. And are you building the right thing would obviously come from the validation or the scenario exploration in and around that particular requirement. Because requirement always talks about the positive scenario, which is verification. But if you have to consider the negative scenario, you have to always go for validation, or are you building the right thing? Now let us consider the business analyst role in project lifecycle. So a business analyst essentially goes through the same set of project lifecycle, but their role differ compared to a quality assurance person. So for example, they authors the requirement documents using various techniques and analyze the requirements during the requirements phase. During design phase, they review the design spec. They make sure the requirements are in sync with the design. During the development and testing phase, they observe and ensure what is built solves the problem or not, and they conduct some acceptance testing. And during the implementation phase, they ensure the stakeholders are ready to receive the product or not. And if some training is needed, they give the necessary training. And during the final deliverable, they make sure if there are any existing problems, the problems are solved, and they look for additional issues if there are any from the end customer. So this is how your business analyst or requirement analyst interface with various stakeholders. So for business requirement, they go to the project sponsor. to understand the size and complexity of the requirement or information they interface with the project manager. For functional and non-functional requirement, whichever has to be developed, they interface with the development team. For requirements, validation and verification, they go to the testing team who approves the requirement, and they interface with the user communities as well. If there are any user specific requirement, if they would like to see some changes in a particular system design or UI screen, they put the end user fee. And finally, the business representative or the other stakeholder, if there are any additional expectation from them, if there are any additional constraint from their side, that is something the requirement analyst or the business analyst needs to understand. This is how your BA interface with various stakeholders. So the requirements analyst essentially bridges the communication between the customer and the development stakeholder. So throughout these slide decks, we have seen what are the common roles of a BA and QA, and what are the different roles for a BA and QA, and how they differ during a project life cycle, and whose accountability is what. Now, if we consider a business analyst role during various testing phases, now we have seen that quality assurance have their own set of roles to play in testing role, which is an expectation from their side. Now, what is expected from a business analyst side during testing phase? So whenever the feature is in build or unit testing phase, essentially in the hands of developer who essentially does the build and unit testing, what BA is supposed to do, they maintain communication lines between the users and the development community, and they observe to ensure that what is built solves the problem, that is during your unit testing. Now during SIT or system integration testing, they confirm all the requirement have been met during the system testing. They clearly define the non-functional requirement wherever applicable, and they track open issues relating to requirements. So essentially, during the development phase and during the testing phase, they interface with the development team and the quality assurance team. Now, acceptance test is something your UAT testing, user acceptance testing, wherein you test as a business analyst with the end customer itself, who would be accountable for that particular product. So here you have to take a lead as a business analyst, and you have to ensure whatever you have delivered, the customer is satisfied with that particular deliverable. I mean, whether all the requirement confirmations are met or not, you have to verify that. So here you have different aspects to play when it comes to user acceptance testing. So it focuses on people who are outside the team, and is the primary person is not finding defect. So you have to ensure that whatever defects are coming in a system, they have to be handled via your unit testing phase and system integration phase itself. When it reaches to the acceptance testing phase, it has to be your constant endeavor that no significant defects are present in the system, because that doesn't indicate that the product is meeting the quality that is expected out of a particular system. You have to ensure that whatever you are delivering to the customer is 100% error free and defect free. So for that reason, whatever is your finding, you have to tell the development team and the quality assurance team in these two phases itself. You have to ensure there are no to minimal defect in user acceptance testing, because you would be sitting with the end customer in that particular phase and testing the product, and if some defects comes out which is very severe in nature, it would be a very awkward moment for you to cover it up, that why the defect came. Because when you are doing the testing with the end customer, you are obviously answerable to the end customer that despite giving so much requirements to you people, why the quality is not being met during the final deliverable. So you have to ensure whatever defects come, they are handled in the testing phase itself, max to max testing phase, not beyond that. So after that, you do the user analysis, wherein the people who actually use the solution or generally active in projects that creates it. This is true for agile projects also. So product owner is someone who is quite involved in user acceptance testing. Not the scrum master, not the scrum. The product owner is something who would be involved in user acceptance testing when it comes to agile way of handling the UAT phase. Then acceptance is like whatever you are building and whatever the feature you are giving, it has to be error free or defect free. Now, having said that, no system is perfect. Now, that doesn't mean that you would give 50% deliverable, 50% bugging the system. It could be like 95% the system is correct, 5% can be negotiable. So that is what acceptance talked about. And testing is like whatever requirements you have written or whatever designs you have created, whether it's meeting those expect or not. So these way, user acceptance and testing are together called as user acceptance testing. User is the people who would be testing. Acceptance is like how much percent requirement is meeting to the specification, and testing is like whether it is meeting to the design artifacts that you have created. So together they are called as user acceptance testing, and BA is heavily involved in this particular phase during a particular project. Now, if you consider the business analyst role in user acceptance testing, so these are the four things that a BA is supposed to do. He has to identify the UAT testers who would be performing the user acceptance testing during the UAT phase. If no one is available, he has to do the user acceptance testing. Then he has to plan the user acceptance testing like within 15 days period. In the first day, 8 hours, what all functionalities he would be testing. In the second day, 8 hours, what all functionality he would be testing. And he would also determine when to do UAT in the planning phase itself. The third item that he would be doing is he would determine when to do user acceptance testing. And finally, the fourth part is he would deliver business value through UAT. Like after performing the user acceptance testing, how much percent requirement are delivered out of those features or functionality, those percentage of deliverables are nothing but your business value that you deliver to the user acceptance test. Okay, now there are certain.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello Sunil, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
So, UAT is done before sprint review.
See, essentially, what happens is like there are two ways. In two different methodologies, like in waterfall methodology, UAT is done after your testing phase gets over. But in agile methodology, the UAT is done in an incremental cycle. So the UAT is essentially done after your sprint demo. So whenever you are doing a sprint demo, you are showing the customer that the system is ready. After the sprint demo, the UAT user starts testing it. And if there are any issues that is coming out of the UAT phase, so they would raise issue and defect, which would go to your product backlog. And in the next sprint planning, it is decided how much percent of core requirement the development team would take, how much percentage of issues the development team would take, and how much percentage of defects the development team would take.
Okay.
Okay. So, Shitish, can you please go on mute? I'm hearing a lot of background noise.
No, actually, that is not from my side.
Okay, who is that person? Okay. So remember, thanks for bringing out that question. In agile project, what happens? In product backlog, there are different categories of issue. There are some bugs, there are some issues or defects. Then there are some change requests. Then there are some new requirements or fresh requirements. So whenever sprint planning happens, you have to prioritize not only requirements, these issues as well, the defects, the bugs, and the change request as well. It's not only about prioritizing the requirements. So that is an important consideration you have to give when you are grooming your product backlog. All of these would go in your product backlog. Now, what are the career risks for a business analyst and a quality assurance? Now, if you consider the risk in business analyst career, these are some of the risk in business analysis career, like the emerging technologies. Like we have a lot of automation technology coming in place, like Internet of Things, then chatbots, artificial intelligence bots, machine learning, then your cloud computing. So these emerging technologies can be a risk if it is not mitigated in a given timeline. So before time, you have to understand those emerging technologies, because waterfall is gone, agile is a methodology. But today, if you consider the emerging landscape, the BA is supposed to know about the emerging technologies as much as possible. That is why a role called as digital business analyst is emerging these days. So digital business analysts are nothing but the business analysts who are more technical in nature. More technical in nature as well. They have a right balance of functional and technical competencies in place. Because without that, they would not have the, core command on that particular emerging technology. Then the other risk in business analyst career is the complex business processes. Now, not all business processes are simplified in nature. There are many business processes which are complex in nature. So being a business analyst, if you are unable to solve the challenge of business complex business processes, then it could be a risk to your careers. Then customer demands. So you have to necessarily mitigate the customer demand. If someone is creeping the scope, then you have to clearly mitigate that scope creep, but not in a harsh way. You have to play a very diplomatic person at that front. You have to mitigate it in a diplomatic way. You cannot say no to anyone. As a business analyst, you cannot say no to anyone, but there are ways to say no with the help of negotiation skills. So when it comes to customer demand, you have to use your negotiation skills. Then, like I said, if you are a techno-functional BA, you would always be in high demand in the market. So technical competency is somewhat needed. Not complete technical competency, like you, someone would come to you and say, maybe your project manager, that you start coding. No, not that much technical competency. But you should be in a position that you should understand what is being coded in the system. Maybe you could write some pseudocode for yourself for a given particular functionality, like if else statement or while statement, the basic programming aspect, or be familiar with the object oriented concepts, what are classes and diagrams. So these are some of the technical flavors that you should have as a business analyst. If not, then it could come as a risk to your particular career. Now similarly, what are the risks in a quality assurance career? As we know, automation is an increasing risk. Then emerging technologies is also a risk for their career, and complex business processes, and again technical competency, is also a risk to a quality assurance career. So to summarize, we have covered what is BA and QA hierarchy, what are the important milestones for BA and QA role, what is the career role comparison for BA and QA. We saw how BA is involved in testing, and what are the career risks for BA and QA. Now, there may be some confusion in your minds that almost BA is similar to QA, but there are certain differentiation, like in terms of their accountability, in terms of their deliverables, and in terms of how they interface with different people. Or else, knowledge-wise, BA and QA are supposed to have equal level of knowledge, because both are the business representative when it comes to verify and validate a particular set of requirements.